somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Say what you want to say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I want to see you be brave. What you want to say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I want to see you be brave. I just want to see you. I just want to see you.
Welcome to the Minority Report Nigeria. I'm Chike Edozien.
I'm Walter.
And today we are in conversation with Frankie Chike Edozien. He's a journalist, regular journalist traveler, and he's the author of the amazing book, The Lives of Great Men, which chronicles the lives of gay men, gay African men across the world, and how they intersect with his. So we'll get right into it. Walter.
Hi. The book, by the way, is something, it's a very necessary story, and
thank you.
Going through it, as part of the blog, the Maza
Mengiste.
I hope I didn't murder the name. He says it's a powerful portrayal of what it means to be a gay Nigerian man, and then Chris Obani says it's a necessary and courageous book. So I wanted to know what does the book mean to you? What vision did you have for it when you were writing?
So, for me, I wanted to write an honest book. I think that was the most important thing. I wanted the book to be honest. I wanted the book to be read and understood as not something written from a very distant place. There's not narratives of African, West African, Nigerian, queer lives. There's not a lot of them out there, and most of them are in fiction. And most of them are not exactly multi-dimensional, you know. You can be a gay person and you can be a terrible person at the same time, and you can be a sexy gay person, and you can have ups and downs, and you can be very successful, you can be all of those things. But when you see the narratives of us in fiction, it's very single story-ish, you know, and there's lots of fictional gay characters that I have been happy to see in books of recent times, but they're still, you know, more often than not non-multi-dimensional, you know, they're just there to serve a specific purpose. Now, in non-fiction, they're just, which is where you want, you know, the bulk of your truth, because after all, a novel is a novel, it's fiction. You know, so characters can be anything. But with nonfiction, where you have real people, real lives, I felt the responsibility to depict ourselves, not necessarily in the best light, but in the most honest light. You know, because we're wonderful and we're fabulous, but we can be problematic too, and that's okay. And that's part of life. And so in my experiences, the people that I know, the people that I dated, the people that I like, the people that, you know, throw shade at me, they all have a story, and all of those stories are valid and they matter. So my vision was to do a memoir that talks about my life and my journey, but is also highlights the lives of the people around me, you know. And I wanted it to be something that was accessible to people, that people could read and then give them something to think about. So that was the vision for the book. I needed it to be accessible, I needed it to be truthful, I needed to be very honest, but I needed it to be able to stop people in their tracks and think about their own prejudices. Because at the end of the day, you know, queer people are just like anybody else.
Yes.
That's really the bottom line. There's nothing particularly special about being gay, and there's nothing particularly terrible about it. We're just like somebody who has, you know, lots of hair, no hair, you know, somebody who's light-skinned, somebody who's dark-skinned, you know, that's just...
No superpowers.
No superpowers whatsoever. I mean, you know, all the stereotypes that people think of, you know, he's got to be a designer, he's got to be limp-wristed, he's got to be all that. All that just out of the window when you know a broad spectrum of gay people. Because they're gay people who you would never think are gay by their outward look. But then again, why do we have this image of what a gay person should be like? Why do we think that a gay person should be, a gay man should be effeminate? Why do we think that a gay man should be good at certain things and maybe not others? You know? So my hope was that if you read this story, if you read this narrative about these people, you realize that they're just like the person next door. And in fact, the person next door might be gay, but you think it's not.
Sure.
So I'm going to jail this case. And
yes.
When I got to that point in the book, I went into the fangirl mode. I bought a mutual friend of ours. I was like, he reported I'm going to jail this case. How can I just learn about this? Why didn't you tell me? You know, so I was really fascinated by that. And I'm really curious what it felt like to you reporting that case, because there are many ways in which his life mirrors yours. He was an immigrant, trying to make his name in the world from, you know, a relatively respectable background.
I mean, I've been to Guinea, I've been to his country, and, you know, when I went to Guinea for the first time, everybody knew who his mother was. Everybody knew who his father was. And Amadou Diallo was this guy who was like, I've left all that baggage behind. I'm going to go to America. I'm going to make it on my own. I'm not going to ask anybody to give me money. And you should tell him. Just call his mother and say to her, don't worry about me. Take care of my younger ones. And he was doing all of these odd jobs and, you know, selling stuff and doing whatever he could. I mean, if he had lived, he probably would have been a great computer scientist, because that's what he wanted to do. But the moment he was killed by police, there was this instant... that was recognizable to me and maybe not to other people, this instant portrayal of him as being the abject immigrant, poverty stricken. He probably didn't speak English, they didn't understand that he should obey the police. After all, he sells things on the street, da 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 da. And what I gleaned from, you know, this is a person who spoke English fluently, spoke French fluently, spoke a little bit of, I think he spoke a little bit of in a Mandarin or one of the Asian languages, because he had gone to school in Thailand for a while. You know, I don't even know if he even spoke Thai. And he also spoke his native Wolof. This is a person that you could say to very conveniently, give me your idea, put your hands up, and he knows what you're talking about. But there was this instant narrative that he was this person who was poorly educated, probably didn't speak English, probably didn't understand what they were saying to him. And somehow, in my mind, all of these things, maybe not necessarily demonizing him, but all of these things were a way to say, you know what, he caused his own death. You know, the whole time that I was reporting that story, I would always think about myself. This is a guy who, like me, came to New York with a couple of $100 in their pocket. This is a guy who was like me. If you go to my hometown, everybody knows my family name. You know, I went to New York and I didn't ask anybody for anything. I was happy to be in a place where I was completely anonymous, is not the word, but unknown. Edozien didn't mean anything to the people in Brooklyn, you know. So I was there by myself trying to make a life for myself, and so I would always think about him. It's like, this guy did everything that I was doing, and yet he got killed this way. And not only did he get killed, they now tried to erase who his real self was. And so I just felt like I needed to somehow try to tell his truth.
Great. And speaking to that erasure, you know, the way in which Ahmad was popularly, you know, described in the media, those buzzwords.
They called him a street peddler.
A street peddler.
they said, I mean, you know, again, like most people, he also wasn't perfect.
Yeah.
You know, because he did come to America by himself, but he also told a lie. He said, you know, he was a refugee or something, you know, so that was not true. I mean, he had parents, they had money, but he was doing what every immigrant has done for generations, which is when you go to a new place, you start again, and you do whatever it takes to keep your head above water, you know. And we have this myth in this, in our part of the world, and we know it. If somebody is away, that means their life must be better. That means they must have money. That means they must have blah, blah, blah. But we don't stop to think about the amount of people who go away and are washing toilets somewhere, washing cars somewhere, doing all of these things just so that they can go to school. You know, nobody thinks about, well, how's that person doing? They're London now. They, you know, they're American, whatever. So, you know, Amadou was in that situation where he was doing whatever it took for him to survive and go to computer school. without having to call him and say, "Mommy, I need money." And I just got him. I felt like he was a kindred spirit. He could have been my friend if I knew him. He could have even been a brother to me, because he was doing what we all do when we want to have a sense of dignity and to do things by ourselves without having other people take ownership of us.
Yes, I'm really interested in knowing how your experiences, or what your experience as a journalist has taught you about countering false narratives.
Yeah.
Like what was going on with Nigeria, particularly as a gay man coming from a country like Nigeria, where false narratives about gay people are constantly peddled, you know, everywhere, and believed by
every
white swath of the population.
Yeah. I think, you know, so for me, it's like, I know that there's a lot of stereotypes about us. I know that people make up things about people they don't know or understand. So things about gays and lesbians, people make all kinds of stuff about our lives. But what I don't find acceptable is when those things seep into the media, because journalists should know better.
Yeah.
Filmmakers should know better. People that are storytellers should know better. And that's where I feel like, okay, the person, random person on the street who thinks like the gay person has three heads or two noses, whatever. But when a person who is, you know, writing an article, and what has bothered me lately has been the way that the media has been used to weaponize bigotry in this country. So for instance, I often see, you know, when I guess the police need money or something needs to be done, there is a roundup of people in hotels and they are arrested. And okay, fine, you gotta go through the process. You arrest people, it's against the law to have a gay marriage. So you arrest people who are dancing or who are at a party, go to court and prove that they have married each other now. What is the need to parade them in front of the newspapers? Yeah? And say that all these people were arrested. And then you then have, you know, this whole circus atmosphere where, you know, people are ashamed, they're embarrassed, the family doesn't know that they may be questioning. And in some cases, they may be totally like not even gay at all, just happen to be hanging out somewhere. And then they have this specter, this cloud on them. But what bothers me even more than that is that when you bring these people out and you know, there was this guy who I saw, and a lot of people made fun of him, and it really hurt me, because fine, his language, his diction was not what we would say standard grammar, but he was bold enough to say, you know what, no one caught me doing anything.
Yes.
And instead of focusing on the fact that here's a person who's standing up for himself, you know, they weaponized that he didn't have proper diction to make fun of him, you know, completely sidestepping the issue as to why police people who have arrested people and not been able to prove anything in court yet is parading these people in the media. You know, one situation I saw in this Lagos a couple of years ago, they even like forced people to take HIV test and then put that out there that, you know, X, Y, the number of them that were arrested have HIV. How many people who are caught for bank fraud or armed robbery have their health information paraded out, you know? And this is another way of sort of like the fear of the difference. And so they are now using all kinds of things as ammunition, you know? That, you know. So if 10 people are arrested for whatever reason and 3 of them have breast cancer, what is that going to do with anything? But when it's, you know, gay people, you really should not be telling me as a consumer of journalism and media what people's health status are if it has nothing to do with what we're talking about. And so these kinds of things bother me, and I feel like the only way to change hearts and minds is to fight back with our own narratives. Hence my I'm so happy that Lives of Great Men is finally available in Nigeria.
Yeah.
Because people in Nigeria can now have the book and read for themselves and make their own decisions and their own judgments. Because when I had the book published first in the UK, which is this lovely version you have, and in the US, it was still easy for people to say, that's our way.
Yes.
That's diaspora.
Absolutely, yes.
That has nothing to do with us, you know? But now, the book is here in Nigeria, so happy with the reception it's received at Akia Festival.
Yeah.
And I'm pleased.
There's a small excerpt I want to read from.
Sure.
It says, Still, I can't help but remember how challenging it is for the majority of sexual minorities who live their day-to-day lives on the continent, a continent where at this time the prevailing sentiment is that it is a taboo and gays need not be seen or heard, or for some even exist. This part, it speaks to the importance of visibility, and I wanted to ask you about this issue about visibility. There are certain sentiments that go around that ever since the SSMPA was signed into law, it's brought about a visibility that some people are calling it like a
yes,
there was something positive, there was something very negative about the law, mm-hmm. but also on the other end, it helped to trust the issue about queer people in Nigeria into the consciousness of Nigerians. So, but some people also decry that they tend to say that it comes at a cost, that this whole championing for visibility and making people out there, it comes at a cost. It makes, like now there's all sorts of anti-gay crimes going on that normally wouldn't have tried if we were just living our lives quietly. And I wanted to know what you thought about the issue surrounding visibility and how important you think it is, especially when it's peculiar to the Nigerian community.
I think visibility is important, but I do not see anything positive about the SMPA. I think that our stories, our narratives, would have come to the forefront regardless, because that is the way life was going. You know, we had already had, people go up and try and make things better with the legislature in the past. We have had people who have come out and dealt with whatever opprobrium it was. So I don't think that this law that was passed by Goodluck Jonathan, I don't think that there is anything good about it. I think visibility is important and people need to stand up and be counted and say, yes, I'm whatever it is I am, and that's okay. But I don't think that people should be forced to do that, because there is such a high cost with being a gay person in this society. You could lose your job, you could lose your house, you could be ostracized. We all know how important family and friends are. So I think that, you know, visibility is important, but more important for me is that people have a coming out process that is comfortable for them, you know, where they can come out to the people they love the most, which is best friends, family members, whoever that is, and then at some point decide if they want to take it a step further. I don't think anybody should be forced to come out of the closet. I don't think anybody should be an activist if they don't want to be.
Yeah, but there's a certain sense in that someone feels that there's this it's secondary guilt. I don't know that, like when you, there's some people who feel that by others talking more about it and others tearing apart the veil that covers the queer community, it sort of makes them self-conscious about, you know, okay, so that person is talking about it, people are going to be looking at me in one way or the other, I'm going to, you know, there are people who feel that they're better just not, don't ruffle any feathers, don't cross any ripples.
I'm not one of those people. I think that, you know, as I said in the book many, many times, that, you know, we may not have called it LGBTQIA, but we have always existed in our histories.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, whether you're looking at Yoruba culture, Igbo culture, Hausa culture, we have always existed and there have been other names for us. I think Africans in general have a problem with labels, especially labels that come from our colonialist past, you know, which is why it's very easy for someone to say that gays or lesbians, they come from England, or England is pushing this on us, or blah, 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 blah. Because we do not like when other people tell us blah, blah, blah. But the reality is we have had queer people in our history. Everybody just needs to take a step and look back. I know, as I said in the book, it's a queer person in our town. I didn't have the words then to say, okay, oh, that's what it is, she's a lesbian. All I knew is that my aunt said, oh yeah, you know, she married that younger woman. And then it's like, we don't know. I mean, she could have married all these men. No. But she chose that woman and she's there in her heart and da 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 da. And people left them alone. because they knew that even though it may have been an oddity, it was not exactly new. They had seen that before in some form or the other. And if we go back to all of our traditional communities, there's always that this is, oh, okay, these people, they're, you know, they're the ones who worship the spirit, and because of that, the woman will now have a male spirit, and then she will take a wife or whatever. Whatever is your rationale for it, it shows that we've always been around.
Yeah.
Whether it's Yandao, Du, or whatever, there's always been around. But when you now bring this, you know, label from the language that is our official language, which is really given to us by colonial powers, people now feel it's a foreign thing. So I don't really think that this whole piercing the veil thing is like, we have been in plain sight if you chose to look. And if you didn't choose to look, then you can spout some nonsense about what your religion tells you, but not what your culture tells you. Because your culture doesn't tell you that we do not exist if you look back at it.
And speaking to what you just said now, which is something I also found interesting in the book, because there are parts in the book where you talk about when you're coming to, you know, to your home, when you just got out of secondary school, and you'd be walking in the room with Lamido, and he was very tactile, you'd hold hands. And I try to picture that happening now.
I know how people could walk around and hold hands. Guys, anyway, today, I don't know what the reaction would be like.
Yeah, there's a hypervisibility that comes with any sort of closeness between people of the same sex. And there seems to be a generational difference in that sort of visibility and that sort of exposure. And while in Nigeria's case, you know, it's easy to say it came from the SSMP, but you also document in your book that, you know, there is something that's happening across Africa
I think certainly West Africa, which I think I know better than most places, I think people have always been tactile and men have always held hands. And it has not meant that there was a sexual connection. It just meant this is, you know, somebody I'm close to, this is my friend, and don't understand how somebody would do that in today's world, which you would just walk down the street and hold your friend's hand, you know, without people immediately thinking that this is some sort of a moral sexual relationship. When, you know, I'm middle-aged now, and I remember a time when it wasn't. It just wasn't.
Yeah, in your book, you talked about a friend of yours, Nguru,
from Kenya.
Yeah, from Kenya,
yeah.
And the stages he took before he came to his live album, and I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm here. Pursuant to that part where you talked about coming out, people coming out, those who come out, there's usually this this thing, this whole fanfare that is placed on the issue about coming out, and some people tend to interpret that to mean, okay, so then I come out, then everything becomes all right. You know, usually some people don't look beyond that. There's an expectation that once we get to the part where you come out, then everything else becomes fine.
So there's two things. One, I think people come out in stages, you know, because you could come out to your best friends and your family members, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you're quite comfortable coming out to people at work. You know, that's where you make a living, that's where you make your money, and a lot of times people you work with are not necessarily your friends. You know, so it's like you're going there to do business, make money. Why do they need to know this? That's how you might rationalize it. But some other people, you know, they can come out to their family, then come out to friends, then come out at work because they think visibility is important, and they are comfortable enough that they know that, okay, this might not get me fired, this might make waves, but it might be easier for the next junior person coming up the corporate ladder to also come out. You know, so I think there's, you know, Americans have this thing where, and I think it's spread around the world now, where they have this National Coming Out Day, where it's like, even if you're gay and you're out, come out to somebody new who maybe doesn't know, like your neighbor or your teacher or somebody who doesn't know. Because coming out is not a one moment process. You don't just say, okay, well, I've told my dad and so I'm out. Yeah, you're out to them, but other people come in and out of your life.
Exactly.
You know, so it's a free impulse process for most people, because you have this sort of like this monkey off your shoulder. And even if you come out to a small group of people, yeah, your close friends and your family, You don't have to pretend anymore. You might be able to say, you know, by the way, I really like Tokbe, which is something you might not be able to discuss with other people. But because you have freed yourself by coming out to this group of people, and let's say the reception has been positive and good, and now they just look at you like any other person, you know, you can have conversations that you've kept inside. You know, you can bring people around that you love or you're dated, around people that know that this is what this relationship is. So coming out, no matter how many times you do it and how big the audience is, it's always a freeing moment, because it allows you to live your most authentic life without having to go through the pretense.
Yeah, well, about that authenticity, there was a moment in your book, I think when I got to that part, everyone I talked to about this book, I always stressed at that point because it spoke to something inside me. When you confronted your dad about, after he did that whole New Year's Eve prayer thing, and then you took him to a room and then you spoke.
We had a conversation. I mean, it's like, again, it is one of those situations where you have, as a gay person, you have to be patient, but at the same time, know when to set limits and boundaries and how
exactly
long your patience will go.
Like, I know of a friend who came out, always comes out to his sister. Like, he has come out to her, and then she calls him, and she's like, okay, so what about your girlfriend? It's like everything else before that had been erased. So what I wanted to ask was, to what extent do you, how important do you think it should be? Like, to what extent do you have to go to make sure that people around you, I'm talking about your maybe family or brothers and stuff, to get it that this is who you are? And that
I always use the Nigerian context, especially generationally.
Yeah.
I think that people should be more patient with older folks.
Okay.
Because sometimes they've just, they don't get it, and we have come through a period where there's a lot of religiosity, and so they tend to think that these things are episodes. You know, okay, yeah, he said he was gay, but that was like last year, so maybe now he's feeling the spirit. And, you know, maybe he will get married, you know? And if somebody's of a certain generation, it's okay to be a little bit patient with them, but at some point you have to be able to say, you know, I can't have this conversation with you again. You know? Just, you know, we've talked about it. For people who are younger, I think that it's, you know, if you're middle-aged or if you're in your 20s or 30s, if you just don't get it, it's not your job to make them get it. But you can tell them once and that's it. But I think, like, you know, someone who is 70 or 80 or 60 even, you know, you can be a little bit patient, because they may not have had that, or they may have had that gay friend, and that gay friend did what was expected of them. So they don't know that their friend is gay, because that gay friend did what was expected by getting married, having children, and maybe having this secret life. You know? So I'm a big believer in that there is no one box, one solution for everybody, and we should be patient with people, because you have had your whole life to come to terms with being gay. You don't expect your father to just get it like 5 minutes after you told him. You've had your own journey questioning yourself, are you really gay, or is this just a fad? You know, should I try another girl and see if it works? You've questioned it, you've gone through all of that internally with nobody, you know, there around you privately. Then you get to the point in your life where you start getting older, I'm not doing this shit anymore, I know who I am. If you don't like it, you don't like it. Then you go and come out to your dad, and he tells you 3 months from now, hey, what about that wife we talked about? And then you get pissed. You've had like 20, 30 years to deal with this. He's had 5 minutes. Calm down a little. Be patient. If people love you, they love you, but sometimes you have to take them along. Now, that attitude that I have for somebody who is older is not what I have for a 20 or 30 year old person.
Yeah.
It's very different. You gotta treat people based on circumstance.
Okay. It's apparent that religion is something that's very important to you.
No, but spirituality is. Okay. My faith is, and it's not really religion per se. But I do believe in God.
God, yeah.
And I pray.
And a very pivotal moment in the book was when you discovered St. Francis Xavier Church in Manhattan.
Yes.
The message was, we welcome gay people, everybody.
And yes, for them, it's not an issue to have gay people in their parish. In fact, they want gay people to come in because they don't feel like any person out there should not have the glory and blessings of God. So they will take you if you're gay or straight, you know. They will ask you to please come, and not just come and you know, be ashamed or be in the back, but please come and really be a part of this community, because God created you, God loves you, and we love you too.
Yeah. So what did you feel like having that message for the first time, as opposed to the fire and brimstone you were
expecting? I think it was really shocking to me, but more than shocking was the amount of other gay people I saw there. And it's not a gay church. And there are churches that are gay churches. This is just a regular parish where there are people.
There's a part about the book that talked about performative heterosexuality, where you have friends who have accomplished much and then travel back to Nigeria and then get married. I was also bewildered by that, and so, you know, reading that and not understanding how, because these were clearly accomplished men, and I would even go as far as saying they also knew who they were. They had also come to, well, some sort of reconciliation with who they were, I think. But I mean, but then you like how, what, even at this moment, because in your book you say something about how eventually you would get to the point where you stop being judgmental.
Yes.
Get off your high horse. Yeah. I wanted to know, I mean, if you've gotten there now.
I think so. I think I'm getting closer.
Okay. But no.
I think I'm getting closer, but I'm not as shocked anymore when I meet someone in Lagos who I find beautiful and charming and whatever, and they tell me they're married with kids and, you know, this is the boyfriend. I'm not shocked anymore. You know, I think I used to be shocked when they were younger than me, because I always thought the younger people are a bit more, you know, more bold, more progressive, more whatever. But I know the situation in this country, and progress is slow, you know. So I've met people who are like, you know, who have all the boxes that you think. They've been abroad, they've gone to school, they've done all these things, they're here, they're social, they're working, they're doing really, really well, but they have wives. And they take their wives out and they do all the things, and then they have a situation. I am, you know, I'm like, I hope you all get to the point where you can be happy.
So let's take our last question.
Please, because I think they want us to go.
What if you could talk to your younger self right now? What is it you would tell him?
Chill. Relax. Enjoy your life, because the moments go by really quickly. Get comfortable with yourself and don't be looking for someone to give you permission to be. Just be.
This was such a delight. It's such a delight having you on the
board. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And that's our show for today, guys. See you next time.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.